What's up, guys? Oh, hold up a second. There we go. What's up, guys? Shane here from Fugitech 3D Printing, and today we're talking about the 713 Maker Upgrade Kit on the Forgitech FT5. How are you doing, guys? So sorry I'm like way over here, but this printer is massive. This is the second printer I ever bought myself. First being my G-Tech i3 aluminum, and then I bought this, the Forgitech FT5. This is the version 1. I call this kind of 1R2. There were some changes from the absolute original when that was first launched in early 2016. I bought mine in August 2016, which the second version came out, had a different bed on it. That's pretty much the only difference between that one and the one that I purchased. So what I did today, well, actually over the past week, is the 713 Maker aluminum upgrade kit installation on this printer. Now, I didn't do the entire kit that they have because some of it I don't think is terribly necessary. His aluminum brackets are beautiful, but way too expensive for me. I got these from Forgitech for, I think, $1.50 or $2 a piece. You need a lot of them. So it's like $50 right there just in aluminum brackets. It would have been like $100 for the 713 Maker kit. Again, they look beautiful, but I didn't really feel like spending the money on that. I bought the Y2Y rails. So here and here are where the two Y rails are. They come totally new with new bearings on them as well. Custom bearings that he assembles for you. Those are fantastic. I also got the X gantry kit, and I got the actual ultralight extruder kit as well, which is what your extruder hangs on, because it's a direct drive printer, and that really lightens everything up. And again, it's aluminum, so it's a lot stronger than what the melanin was. I also did the build plate, or actually should say the Z-axis. I didn't do his build plate. It's $70, I think, for the heated build platform, and they recommend hooking on 120 volt silicon heat pad on it. I have a 12 volt on mine, which really won't heat up that one very well. I could do what I have mine, where I have the actual heated plate, then I have a piece of cork, and then I have the silicone pad, and then the piece of glass all sandwiched together in there. I could do that with that kit, but that's another $70 upgrade, which I'm not really too sure I'm gonna do that right now. It took me a long time to buy all these because it's very expensive, but it's actually super worth it depending on where you live. Now, I'll talk a little bit about that. For years, I had said the melanin is good enough, and it is, if you live in a dry climate. Well, I lived in the desert last, and it was great because it was super dry there. Now I live right north of the rainforest, south of the rainforest. I'm right near the rainforest, and yeah, it's super humid here. Like right now, rainy season's coming along. Where's my thing at? And I'm only sitting at 39% humidity right now. Well, when rainy season gets here starting in the next month or so, I'm gonna be sitting at 80% humidity in my office. That's crazy amounts. It's hard to keep filament dry, and that melanin, it definitely does see some moisture get into it, and it gets soft, and you have to really tighten down all those bolts again. Well, I didn't want to have to do that anymore. So about a year and a half ago, before I moved, I put on the corner brackets, and now finally, after I've been talking about it for so long, I put all of the 713 Maker kit on there. Now, before any further, this is not a tutorial on how to do this upgrade. He provides great pictures on the website for each of the products. You can figure out how to install them. It's really not that difficult, but I will show some close-ups of different parts and they're moving and whatnot. I also want to talk about some upgrades that I've done to this printer recently to try and make it a little bit better. So where to start with that? So to start off, obviously, I did those few parts of the 713 Maker. It took me about 25, maybe 30 hours total in order to do that work, just because it takes a long time to take everything apart. Remember where you put it all, and to take out each of the old pieces to ensure that your rails don't come off of the sleds, or the sleds don't come off the rails, because if they do, you lose all the bearings and then you're screwed. So making sure you have all of those zip tied properly. I also have on here the 3D Upfitters acrylic kit that they sent me to review. It's an expensive kit. It's very nice though. But now I'm kind of angry because I had cut it to in order to fit more better, a little more properly. And now I have kind of these gaps where the melanin pieces were. There's now no longer a piece there. So I might try and 3D print something to take up these gaps just to make it a little more airtight again. But I'm not sure what I'm going to do about that. I just have to figure that part out. But anyways, yeah, so the 713 Maker kit took me about 25 to 30 hours to get done. Then I did go ahead and worry about the feet. So I went ahead and made up some new feet for this using racquet balls. These are super bouncy, and they're great for absorbing movement on 3D printers. I actually have this on three, four other printers right now, my two CR10s and the Anycubic COSL, so three other ones right now. And this works out fantastically. I was using these little tennis practice balls and they were fitting in these little cups that I made for them and they just did that. And after about probably 4 or 5 months of it sitting on there, it really squished these almost all the way down and almost the blue plastic was what was touching the floor. It's like, ooh, that's not so good. I have a lot of these because I was using this on several other printers. I'm still using it on the Forgitech 2020 i3 as that's a pretty lightweight printer and these work out well for that. I could use this on something like the Mark III or a Hypercube or something like that. But these big heavy duty printers, you need a heavy duty ball. So that's why I chose racket balls. And again, they work out great and no matter what anybody tells you, the vibrations that the printer puts into these has nothing to do with print quality whatsoever. I still get perfect prints without any ripples whatsoever because the gantry is not twisting or anything like that. That's where you're gonna see any type of translation of movement into your prints. But as long as the entire printer is moving, you're not gonna see any of those issues in your printer. So if anybody brings that up, they're just talking out their butt. They have no idea what they're talking about. So these are definitely a great upgrade for any large format printer that you have that you really want to quiet it down. This is what you really should be using. So a couple things that I've already done to this, I don't know if I've ever really talked about them, but I do have stepper motor dampeners on here on the X and the two Y motors. They both have that extruder, you don't put it on there, and the Z, it's not required because it moves so slow. Those aren't really moving that much. But the X and Y really take a lot of that vibration that translates into the frame, that translates into your tabletop, takes a lot of that out, and then even more so by adding on the racquetball feet. So I'm also running a mixture of stepper drivers on here. I'm running some CMC 2208s, some LRV 8729s, super duper old ones. They were out before TMC 2100s even hit the market. I put those in a good over 2 years ago. And TMC 2100s, they might have just come out, but they were like super difficult to use back then, and you had to do the soldering on them. 2208s and 2209s now are just basically plug and play, so those are fantastic. But those are what I'm using here in order to drive this. It makes it run a lot quieter than using some standard drivers, so I really like those. I also went ahead and did the dual end stop mod. Now, I also was very against that for years because using the brass T8 nuts on these lead screws, you didn't really need to have it because the gantry didn't move down. Unless you had those things like super lubed, which they don't really need to be, it's your Z. It moves so slow and 0.1 millimeter at most at a time, you're not really needing to have those super lubed or super loose at all. My platform was rock solid. Now when I upgraded to the 713 Maker Kit, it comes with the Dirlin or Drylin, however you pronounce that, anti-backlash lead screw nuts, and those move super easily, enough so that I can open this up and just basically push down on the gantry and it moves. It's very simple. I have it all the way down, so it's not as easy to move down there. But anyways, it moves up and down super easily and does fall now. So because of that, I had to go ahead and upgrade. Well, I had to downgrade because I was running my Y motors separately. So I had two stepper drivers running the two stepper motors. So I put the Y back together and I just upped the voltage on that and we'll see over time how that ends up working out. And I went ahead and running now two separate Z motors with the dual end stop. And now when it homes, you'll see it come up. One side will hit, the other side will hit. It'll do a safety check and go back up and boom, it is right there. And it's been working great. I've run a slew of tests. I have a bunch of tests just sitting in there. I've kind of been testing out. Also, because I did that, I needed to upgrade the firmware. Now, I was running 1.1.0, I think, on this, or 1.00 Marlin on here. It's from 2016. I'm a big believer if it ain't broke, don't fix it. And that firmware, you've seen the prints over the years that I've gone off the machine, are almost perfect. They print absolutely, this thing prints great. All types of filament, because I have this enclosure, I can print ABS like a dream, ASA, polycarbonates, nylons, anything that really likes heat and likes to be in a chamber, boom, it print out just great on this machine. So, but now that I've upgraded to 1.1.9, I'm using my own version because I was gonna use Tim's, but I didn't really figure out easily enough in there how to do the dual Z, so I just said, screw it, I'm just gonna make my own, and I made that from scratch. So it's taking me some time to dial it in, and I do need to kind of play with it a little bit. I think my E-steps need to be adjusted a little bit more. I'm seeing a tiny bit of under extrusion on my top layers on prints now. So I'm gonna do some more with that. I also added in linear advance with that. Now I edit my E-steps, I'll have to edit my linear advance as well, but I tried doing the linear advance just to see, how's that really gonna help me out? Am I gonna see anything better in prints? I'm seeing a little bit, but I need to experiment a little bit more. I am seeing a little bit of ripple in the X direction now, so I need to figure out what that's from. Belt's tight, actually brand new belt, replaced the belt just because I thought that might have been an issue. But I am seeing a slight ripple in the X direction on a Benchy. That's the only one that's really seeing it, just because of the curve on the bow. But my coin, I don't see that at all. I do see the under extrusion of my coin though. And over supports, it's doing fantastic. Just finishing the last little tweaks of getting my first layer just absolutely perfect. But once you get that set, I hadn't leveled this machine in 2 years, I guess, about. So I hardly ever have to level this machine, or almost never have to, I should say. Almost never have to level any of my machines because I don't move them. They go on the shelf and they print. That's what they do. But anyways, I did have to still tweak that a little bit. I'm getting a little too much squish, so support was a little bit hard to get off because of that. So kind of seem to play with it a little bit more. I think the PEI is also getting a little worn out after 3 years of use. So I'm gonna go ahead and Scotch Brite that, or use some steel wool, try to retexture that PEI sheet and see if I can kind of revitalize that now. As I'm using glue stick a little too much on it, I prefer not to use glue stick at all if I can, but I'm seeing a little much in here. I also do have an ultra plate that I could throw in here, an ultra base from AnyCubic, which is one of my favorite bases to use. I might have just throwing that on here because that is one of my favorite build plates to use for PETG, PLA, ABS, pretty much everything sticks to it. I've had a few little pieces peel up from like TPUs, but as long as you let it cool, it's a really good print base, so I like that one. It is a silicone heated bed. As I said before, I did a video a long time ago about doing that, which is a great upgrade, 12-volt silicone heated bed for like, back then they were cheap. They're a little more expensive now. I think they're up to like $50, where it's like $70 for a AC one. So, but I am running it off of a MOSFET. I might replace the fan. The fan after 2 years is still getting a little bit loud, even though I have some Noctua dampers on it. I did get some Sunlu maglevs in from DigiKey, which are super quiet and move a lot of air. Might end up putting one of those on there. The part cooling fan, that is printed with resin actually. So that's right off of my Elegoo Mars 3D printer. And so far seems to be okay. I don't really know the heat properties of resin. Someone told me that it would be a good upgrade. It should be a little more heat resistant than other regular, you know, FDM 3D prints or FDM 3D printed materials. But the jury's out on that because I did have a piece of it hit the bed spring and it did chip. So, a little unsure about that one. It is really close to the bottom and it's like the tolerance that's pretty tight. So I think I'm gonna need to put in the heater block a little bit more in order to bring the nozzle out some, or just bring the heater block up a little bit more and get a little closer to the actual cold end, the heat sink part of the E3D V6, just to see if I can have that up a little bit more, because it was hitting a few pieces that come up. It does hit. So I kind of need to play with that just a little bit more, but so far I'm happy with it. It is using a 5015 turbine fan, so it blows out lots of cool air. It cools very fast, it's very effective, but it's a little too close to the prints. So yeah, I think that's pretty much covers it. Again, this has been a work in progress printer for 3 years now. Again, it was the second printer I ever purchased, and it is still by far probably my favorite one. The Hypercube's a big favorite of mine, but this one, it just works. It is an absolute workhorse for me. I know some people have had problems, but if you put the time in the beginning, take your time to build the machine, takes about 20 to 25 hours to build it off the bat. It does take a while to build it first. And if you do any upgrades on it, it takes a while again. It is a big printer. There are lots of parts. Just to access these Y plates, I have to take off the sides, the top, and this side. Actually, I have to take off the cross beams as well. Take off a lot of pieces just to get in there to be able to replace something like that. But everything else you can easily access, and it is super heavy. But if you don't have these side plates on, everything is so easy to get to. I can't stress that enough. It is so easy to work on this without these side plates. So thankfully this top piece here is screwed in by 8 M4s, so I can easily untwist all of those T-nuts, pull off the top, and access the extruder easier. I can still get in the front. It's a great big door in the front, and you have the door up top. Again, those just kind of work out well for me, and again, printing anything that requires high heat. It's an all-metal E3D V6 with a hardened nozzle from MicroSwiss. So literally any filament that I want to print, I can put through here. I have a max set to 275 just in the firmware. For, I don't know why, I could easily set that to 300 and go from there, because that all of that hot end can take that type of temperature without any issues at all. The only problem I have to worry about is maybe these end stops might soften up, or the resin will soften up from the part cooling fan. So again, but I can always take that off if I need to. Lots of different things with that. The only problem I really had once I was putting this all back together was my pancake stepper motor. The shaft was not long enough to account for this melanine. I was using the Franken shuttle, which had very, very small amount, maybe 2 millimeters between the motor and the Titan extruder. So it was very short. This now has 5 millimeters between it, and it just isn't long enough for that. So I'm using another one that I got long time ago with a very cheap Titan extruder that I got off like AliExpress for like $5 or $6, like stupid cheap, or maybe like 10 with the motor. But I think I am gonna replace that with a longer shaft, because it is almost long enough to come to the front of the Titan extruder faceplate, which it should come right there. It makes it almost all the way through the idler arm, or like the tension arm in the extruder, but it's not quite there. So I think I will upgrade and replace that later. But aside from that, it's a fantastic build. It was a lot of fun. If you guys are thinking about doing this, I'll put links down for 713 Maker down below in the video description. If you guys want to check out any other parts I've done, there'll be lots of links down there. If you want to check out any of that stuff, it is a great kit. Again, it is not cheap, but if you want to kind of take your printer to the next level, especially live in a humid climate, or if you want to do any high heat stuff, it is definitely well worth checking out. Hope you guys enjoyed this kind of overview of my FT5 and the things I've done on it. If you have any questions or want anything more in depth, I'm happy to answer your questions down in the comments, or you can hop on my Discord and ask me any questions there. I'm on there every day. There's lots of other people on there as well with 3D printing experience and making in general. So feel free to hop on there and ask your questions. And that's the end of it, guys. So hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, give it a thumbs up. If not, thumbs down. Either way, again, I'd love to hear from you in the comments down below. If you have an FT5, how it's doing for you, a version 1 or version 2, or if you have any questions on these upgrades, please ask them down below in the comment section. If you guys want to stay tuned to what's going on, make sure you hit that subscribe button and hit that bell icon. That way you get a notification when I upload new content and do any live streams. If you guys support me financially and help me do things like upgrade printers with crazy kits like this, you should become a patron. It only takes $1 to get access to my after show and the access to the Patreon feed. It also gives you status on my Discord with a special Patreon section in there as well. So make sure you guys check that out. And again, every dollar there I put right back in the channel to things like this. So I thank all my current patrons for all their support over the years. Otherwise, you can help out financially. There's some one-time donation links down there if you want to just throw me a couple bucks, buy me a coffee, or if you want to use any of the affiliate links, update your bookmarks with those. There's also coupon codes down there. Make sure you check all those out for different vendors. You might be able to save a couple bucks on your next filament or 3D printer purchase. Thank you for tuning in, guys. Until next time, happy printing.